How many times did you fake the CPK index in the last month? If your CP is just below the required threshold, will you adjust only few numbers, or will you generate the whole set randomly? The process capability metrics are quite useful and important tool, unless it is used in absurd ways or for absurd purposes. I have seen quite a few factories which experience a rapid growth of departments whose primary mission was to fabricate process capability reports. The people in these departments often ask questions like,
"Do I really have to fake the numbers? Wouldn't it be better if I just delete one or two?"
Despite the apparent unemployment reduction, one may ask if there are other, safer ways in which the industrial enterprises can demonstrate their social responsibility. First, we must remember that the capability indices are based on statistics, and as such they are imprecise. More accurately, they are an estimate of the unknown reality. Before you interpret the concrete number, make sure to know what the confidence bounds are. For example, if the CPK is 1.33, calculated on 250 observations of a normally distributed process, the 95% confidence bounds are 1.17 and 1.49. It means that if one repeats the experiment, the result can easily be 1.25 or 1.4 for the very same process under the very same circumstances. The numbers are just the same. It does not make any sense to be nervous when your process shows 1.3 instead of the required 1.33. If you want to be statistically correct, use the lower bound as the criteria. You can define your requirement by setting, for example, the lower bound of the 95% confidence to be at least 1.2. When defined in such way, you can increase the precision by acquiring more observations for processes that are just slightly above the limit. And you can save quite some time for processes that notably exceed the criteria. In the more advanced strategies, similar effect is being achieved by shifting the threshold according to the number of observations, but that is quite unfortunate as this uses untested assumptions about the distribution. Make sure you know what type of process you are observing. If it is a machining or weighing, then you can optimize the target. However, when it is die pressing or plastic molding, and the process has a CPK equal to 1 every time over and over, then it is just fine. Do not calculate the process capability for everything. Choose only the important characteristics. But make sure to choose all the important characteristics, not just those that are easy to collect. In general, there are three types of them. The specification characteristics are designed to guarantee function of the part in the assembly. They must be met, otherwise the produced part may not be functioning properly, or it may not be as reliable as expected. The specification should be the primary focus in all processes. The manufacturing or technological tolerances are connected to the specific way in which a part is produced. These are usually tighter than the specification, as they have to account for the specific way in which the part is handled during the process. For example, let's take two parallel planes. If the part is positioned on some third feature, like the clamping plane, the manufacturing tolerances to this feature must be reduced. Only then the mutual tolerance between the features will be preserved. However, breaching the manufacturing tolerances does not necessarily result in breaching the specification tolerances. These are therefore secondary and are worth observing only when it is more economic to control these rather than the specification. When the production technology changes, don't forget to calculate the manufacturing tolerances again based on the specification. Employing the previously used manufacturing tolerances would result in unnecessary expenses. The last category is the process parameters. These are indirect characteristics usually related to the machine setting rather than the direct specification. Concerning the crankshaft, this is typically the temperature control during hardening and annealing. The indirect characteristics influence the quality of the final specification, but may vary depending on the circumstances. Collecting the data on process parameters is crucial for gaining knowledge about the process and using it in further optimization, but it is seldom a good candidate for process capability checking. Again, it only makes sense to check the capability of these when it is more economic than with the resulting specification. The process capability is not directly related to the economic efficiency of the production. Sometimes it may be better to lower the overall capability down to an acceptable level. Let's see when it pays off. When you are filling 20-liter containers with, let's say, oil, and the tolerance is +0, +5%, you will save a lot of oil by staying close to the lower tolerance. In other cases, the increase in capability may pay off by reducing the expensive rework or scrap. As always, be rational. Process capability is an important tool, but it must be used properly. As with every such metric, its use and interpretation must be competent using the technical knowledge about the processes. Fabricating the reports just for the sake of some insane auditing is not only absurd, it is also dangerous. Too often the manufacturing and quality engineers waste their time doing the useless paperwork when they should be on the shop floor. The other danger is a creation of parallel universe of reports and statistics that is completely unrelated to the real world in which the real products are actually made. The process capability is an idea too good to be used only as a superstitious ritual.